Next on News Talk, AM 1480 WLEA, the Newsmaker Show with Kevin Doran.
It's Brian O'Neill in for Kevin Doran again, on with our usual Thursday guest, Dr. Christian Kampf. Dr. Kampf, thanks for calling in.
It's great to be talking to you. I'm talking from St. Louis, Missouri.
And you say you're at a conference in St. Louis. Tell us about the conference, Dr. Kampf.
Conference is a meeting of campus ministries for students. There are almost 500 young Christian students here, and listening to people who are both ministers and lay people like myself talking about important social issues that involve their future, because, one, they have their own issues as students on a campus, but they're there so they can, you know, have a life. And so we're talking about issues of freedom on campus and also issues about marriage, about their life in the future, about what it means to be a citizen, and the role of church and state, which, of course, we're telling them is not that of absolute wall of separation that Mr. Jefferson mentioned in a famous letter in 1802, but on the contrary, a society in which both church and state play an active role in society and in the lives of the citizens, especially Christian citizens. So we've had a lot of good discussions. These are very bright kids. And, you know, when you hang around with them, you feel good about the future.
Well, Doc, you said the separation in church and state, that's a big leftist doctrine as it's misinterpreted by some, wouldn't you say?
Yes, it absolutely is. The original idea, which we find in Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 13, we find in Dante's work, we find in the founders of Protestantism as well, Luther and Calvin, is that God rules through his two kingdoms. One is the church, which is for Christians, of course, which are for believers. But he also rules through the state. The state is not something totally separate, but it's not the same. And the state rules everybody. It includes Christians and non-Christians, believers and non-believers, on and on and on. And those, but it's still God ruling. That's what it really meant. It's just that we need to distinguish between his ruling through the church, which is meant for believers, and his ruling through the state, which is meant for everybody. And, you know, James Madison understood this very well. We have a wonderful letter of him in 1821 in which he specifically talks about the correctness of this doctrine. You remember, he wrote to a minister named Schaeffer in 1821. And the Supreme Court, since the days of Felix Frankfurter, has taken one letter from Thomas Jefferson to the Baptist of Connecticut, Baptist, in which he talks about building a wall of separation between church and state. And that is not in the Constitution. It's not in the Bill of Rights. Madison penned the words of the Bill of Rights, so he knew what it was about. The first Congress had ministers opening with prayer, as they still do. They appointed chaplains in the military who are still there. I mean, you could just go through the list of indications that there was no wall of separation. There are two different great institutions, church and state, and they interact with one another and they support one another, but they are separate because they have separate missions. And those are just like the separation of powers in our own government with president, legislature, executive legislature, and judicial. And it's exactly parallel to that. And that's the real meaning, not that religion should be chased out of the public square and no Christian should have freedom of speech to express his views as a Christian. On the contrary, it meant exactly the opposite. And that was well understood by Americans for 200 years, and now, as you pointed out, it's been really misrepresented based upon one very unrepresentative letter of Thomas Jefferson in 1802.
Dr. Kampf, John Boehner is once again the House Speaker. Wondered if you wanted to comment on that. You know, see, a lot of people in the Tea Party, even in the House, were unhappy with that. The House, some in the Tea Party in the House tried to block it. Word is, according to Drudge and Politico, there's been political retribution against those congressmen who tried to unseat Boehner. Your thoughts there, Dr. Kampf, on John Boehner taking over once again?
Well, I mean, Boehner is a compromise candidate because he gets along with more people than anybody else. And I don't want to be unfair because nobody's perfect. You know, Boehner has tried to keep the group together and to listen to the different sides. But he's not a strong figure. He's not very articulate. When it comes to confrontations with the president, he rarely ever expresses himself clearly and effectively. And you can certainly give the president that much credit to say that he does express his views clearly and effectively.
Sean Hannity was making fun of John Boehner on Facebook. As of Wednesday morning, Hannity had a picture posted up on his Facebook page that showed John Boehner on Tuesday afternoon giving a kiss on the cheek to House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, and Hannity pretty much said, that tells you what you need to know.
Well, yeah, I mean, Sean has been very articulate on this issue, and usually Sean tries to stay in the conservative mainstream. And in the case of Boehner, he is irritated at Boehner. He thinks that Boehner has sold us out, that he's more interested in playing golf with the president and playing kissy-kissy with Nancy Pelosi than standing up for the reasons why Americans are disgusted and why they voted the Republicans in. And to that extent, Mitch McConnell's recent explanation that he understands that there are certain policies that were important in the Republican victory last fall. And we wonder whether John Boehner gets that or whether he's looking for a way to get along with the president. The other side of the coin is that it's clear the president wants to get along with Congress. He's built up a very successful personal situation, not successful for his party, on the opposite, but successful for him as heroically standing up against Republicans who don't want to do anything. And that isn't clear that that's true. Anyhow, we'll be able to see now, because the Republicans have already presented a couple of ideas that they would like to pass through, including the Keystone Pipeline for energy. And the president has already said he doesn't want to. He's going to veto it. And this is going to be a big moment for the Democrats who are running for office in 2 years in the Senate and the House, because if they side with the Republicans, they can tell their constituents, I don't do what Barack Obama wants all the time. And it certainly hurt a lot of Democrats a lot that it could be said that they voted with the president 98% of the time. So the president may find himself in some trouble if he tries to veto very popular items like the Keystone Pipeline, which looks to the average American like a complete win-win. We get more oil, we become more independent, and we get jobs. What's the negative side? The average American doesn't see it.
You know, one of the big themes of the Rush Limbaugh show is don't go third party. Over the years, he said that many times. Now I'm not sure that Limbaugh will hold to that, because he's been so critical of John Boehner, as has Sean Hannity. And you see that Limbaugh and Hannity have both moved strongly into the Tea Party camp. Wondering, Dr. Koff, do you think that a third party to replace the Republican Party could or will pop up now?
As Yogi Berra liked to point out, predicting the future is always difficult. If Boehner compromises with the president on immigration in a way that convinces conservatives that the Republican Party is just, you know, the right-hand side of the Democratic Party, there could be a third party. We've seen in England that the UKIP, anti-European Union group under Nigel Farage, has been successful, and so far it's only been the European elections, which are only have a secondary effect, but they've been successful. Marine Le Pen's National Front is very popular in France, and the recent acts of terror there will do nothing but make them even more popular. So we are looking at a number of countries where conservative third parties have been successful, and at least potentially successful, and the chance of success. And so this is going to be very tempting. When Nigel Farage came to America and spoke on various conservative groups, almost everybody started off criticizing him for being a third party and drawing support away from the conservatives. in England, and almost everybody ended up by saying, he makes a good case. He's actually helped make the conservatives more conservative to some degree. And he's certainly given frustrated Brits the feeling that the democracy is not a waste of time and they're not wasting their vote. And I think that was a terrible problem in 2012 for the Republican Party. So people say, why vote for a guy who won't stand up against the president? And that's the problem that Boehner is going to face, because on the one hand, he needs to look as though he's willing to cooperate. But on the other hand, if he sells out on a really key issue, my prediction it'll be immigration. If he sells out on that, then I think there could well be a third party. It's even likely that there would be a third party.
Will they call it, do you think, the Tea Party?
That's a great question, and the answer is, I can't give an obvious answer. It has a clear brand. The press has made it negative in the eyes of many Americans. But I think if Americans listen to what the Tea Party stood for, a lot of them would say, well, you know, I actually do agree with that. So it'll be known as the Tea Party, even if it has a name like, you know, America First Party or, you know, We Love Our Country Party, whatever.
Talking with our regular Thursday guest, Dr. Christian Koff, here on a Thursday, January the 8th. We'll be back with Dr. Koff in just a moment. Back on the Newsmaker Show, I'm Brian O'Neill, and Dr. Christian Koff is a professor at the University of Colorado in Boulder. Today, though, he's in St. Louis, Missouri, which brings us to the topic of Ferguson and protests. Dr. Koff, what are the radio stations and TV stations and newspapers talking about in Ferguson right now? Because I know the protest movement is still going on in various cities.
Yes, those of us who live elsewhere may feel like we've heard enough about Ferguson, but here in the St. Louis area, it is still a regular topic on the local news. I mean, it's actually, as you take the train in from the airport, the train goes right by Ferguson, and there continue to be protests. There continue to be a environment in which police stations are invaded or there's confrontation with police. And this is also happening elsewhere as well, but it's still, it's interesting when you live outside, you think, well, the national press isn't covering it anymore, it isn't going on. On the contrary, it's still a very important part of not only the Ferguson scene, but also the wider St. Louis scene. And a lot of these protests are taking place in downtown St. Louis, so it affects the entire area, what's happened. And I'll just give a brief analysis, which people who live here may have a different view, is that this has created a culture of protest in which, protesting first and actually, writing letters to the newspaper or, having meetings with people or having votes takes a very secondary place to public disruptive protesting, especially aimed at the police, but also at other public institutions. And one really wonders whether the protesting is going to be added to the list of the rights of citizenship, along with voting and, volunteering for Little League and Meals on Wheels, because it's now become a very lively part of the St. Louis scene. And as far as I can tell, this is getting to be true in New York as well, and maybe even on the West Coast as well.
Looking at... Twitter today as I talk to you, World War II's veteran ceremony, and this is a living World War II vet, 100 years old. They said the ceremony was crashed by Ferguson protesters.
Yeah, there's a lot of talk about it. There's a lot of, it's a source of considerable split between left and right and also between black and white. And because fighting in World War II is, one of the few things there's a sort of national consensus on. And this guy, in one sense, he was a brave soldier in his day, and he lived to be 100, and he stands for a part of our national past that we're proud of. And I think that was the point of the disruption, is that we have no right to be proud of anything. At least a lot of Americans are taking it that way, that the protests are going on from specific, concrete, this policy is bad, change it, which many Americans think is a completely legitimate place for protest, to our national narrative is flawed, it is wrong, insofar as it presents America as sacrificing for the common good of the world. It's simply wrong because this is a bad country. And I think a lot of Americans feel that use of protest is inappropriate, it's wrong, and it's going to disrupt, you know, the national unity, the social contract that we all have with one another about respecting one another in certain areas.
Yeah, that seemed to be widely condemned as an obnoxious thing to do, crashing a 100-year-old man's World War II remembrance ceremony. Another big story out in Missouri, where you are, Dr. Kopp, one of the grand jury members is suing the prosecutor who handled the Michael Brown case, saying that he did not portray the case accurately. Any talk of that in the news out there?
There is some talk of it, but it's so technically legal that it so far as basically they move to their legal expert who, you know, starts talking in terms that I think most people's eyes glaze over. But certainly questioning the grand jury process is part of this new narrative that's going on. And we're seeing a number of attempts to. Usually the grand jury process is viewed as, you know, an important stage before going to trial, so that everything doesn't go to trial. Our system will be swamped if every possible accusation went to trial and involved 12 jurors and a complete legal staff on either side. So the grand jury process serves a very important function, and this is being questioned in a fundamental way. And the idea that it was misrepresented, misdone, mishandled, we've now heard several times, and most of the things I've heard have been rather technical. And it's hard to imagine that they would, you know, ever have any long-term positive effect, but they can certainly have a short-term negative effect in causing people to doubt the safeguards that are set up in our system to protect people.
You know, as we're talking, I'm looking through Huffington Post and the Drudge Report, and both sides are saying that Boehner is getting political revenge and retribution, I think is the word, against the members of the House who worked against him getting his speaker role back. Both the left and the right, Huffington and Drudge, are both reporting on that. I think the Tea Party is going to look at this, Dr. Kopp, and says, oh, he compromises with Obama, but he gets tough with us. So we may see a break from the Republican Party on this issue.
Yes, even this issue, if he were felt to be unfair enough, and if he were felt to be vindictive enough, because he sells himself as Mr. Huggy Bear, and I'm so lovable, and I cry all the time, and I kiss Nancy Pelosi. If it turns out that when you really question him, that he's remorseless in punishing you, I think that could be quite a blow to him. Yes, I do. Certainly there are a number of people, ranging from the Heritage Foundation to Sean Hannity, who and Rush Limbaugh, who would turn on him strongly if it were. They've already shown lack of confidence in him. They would turn on him strongly if he were to show real vindictiveness. And I think it was a very silly sign to do so. I think he should be trying to stay in touch. And he hasn't so far shown he's willing to do that.
We've been talking with Dr. Christian Kopp in the University of Colorado in Boulder. Dr. Kopp, any final thoughts before we go?
Well, I think that we're going to have a year that is going to be more financially prosperous than recent ones have been, partly because so much of the rest of the world is in trouble. Russia's in free fall. China is no longer maintaining its high level of productivity. And America, I think, has some chances to really, you know, recover and even create jobs. And if that's the thing that I think Boehner and McConnell most want to do. And I think that would be great news for the country and great news for upstate New York.
Dr. Kopp, as always, thanks for joining us.
Great pleasure to talk to you.
And ABC is next on AM 1480 WLEA Hornell.